رسول الله حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله.
Allah our God is the greatest, the one and only glory to him. He born in humans to be the best and give his best religion to them. Allah our God is the greatest, the one and only glory to him. He born in humans to be the best and give his best religion to them.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah. As-salatu was-salamu ala nabiyyihi wa mustafah wa ba'd. My dear viewers, welcome to another live edition of our program, Gardens of the Pious. Today's episode, by the grace of Allah, is number 390. And it will be the second in studying chapter number 152. That is the second episode. And this chapter, as a reminder, بَابُ مَا يُقَالُ عِنْدَ الْمَيِّتِ وَمَا يَقُولُهُ مَنْ مَاتَ لَهُ مَيِّتٌ. This chapter, which we studied most of its ahadith, remaining for us only one single hadith, deals with what should be said and uttered in the presence of a dead person, and وَمَا يَقُولُهُ مَنْ مَاتَ لَهُ مَيِّتٌ. The person who lost a family member, what should he say? So today's hadith is agreed upon its authenticity. It is collected by Imam Bukhari and Muslim, may Allah have mercy on them. And it is narrated by Usama ibn Zayd ibn Haritha, may Allah be pleased with him and his father. Hibbu Rasulillah wa ibn Hibbi Rasulillah. One of the very beloved to the Prophet and his father was too, Zayd ibn Haritha. So Usama narrated that qala arsalat ihda banatin nabiyy sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ilayhi تدعوه وتخبره أن صبيا لها أو ابنا في الموت فقال للرسول ارجع إليها فأخبرها أن لله تعالى ما أخذ وله ما أعطى وكل شيء عنده بأجل مسمى فمرها فلتصبر ولتحتسب. This is a segment of the hadith. The hadith also will be tackled in the following chapter. It will be the second hadith in the following chapter. We will learn something new in this hadith. But now in this chapter, what a person should say upon losing a beloved one. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sitting, and one of his daughters sent to him a message that her son was in his last breath. He was dying. And she requested him to come to attend that, to be with her during this time. So Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, sent back with the messenger to inform her to say, to Allah we all belong. In anna lillahi ta'ala ma akhadh, to Allah belong what he has taken, and to him belongs what he has given. Lillahi ma akhadh, وَلَهُ مَا أَعْطَى وَكُلُّ شَيْءٍ عِنْدَهُ بِأَجَلٍ مُسَمَّى. And everything with him has a limited span, a limited time, a limited period in this life. So ask her to be patient, to endure this calamity patiently. وَلْتَحْتَسِبْ يعني to anticipate the reward from Allah the Almighty. From that we learn that number one, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, upon losing his grandson, because that was the son of Zainab, the daughter of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so she realized that her son is dying, and she asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to attend. She was hoping that he can do something, but since he was dying, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted to confirm that no one can stop death from taking place, even Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. لكل أجل كتاب. This is what Allah Almighty said. Everything, every creature has a fixed lifespan. Once its term is due, لا يستأخرون ساعة ولا يستقدمون. No one will actually gain an extra moment, nor will he die a few moments before their due term. So if he's dying, he's gonna die. No one can stop that. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, you should say, inna lillahi ta'ala ma akhadh. Now he has taken the soul of your son, of your daughter, of your loved one. Guess what? He belongs to Allah. He belongs to Allah. وَلَهُ مَا أَعْطَى. As he's the one who gave him to you, he collected his soul back. So be patient and endure that patiently, because everything has a limited time, and once the term or time is due, no one can stop this person or the soul from going unto Allah the Almighty. In the hadith of Umm Anas radiallahu anha, Umm Sulaym, when she was married to Abu Talha, and they had a son, and the son was very sick, but Abu Talha left for some business, and when he returned, he asked his wife, how is our son? She said, he is much better than before. Askanu ma yakun. He's very quiet. Doesn't feel any pain anymore. He said, alhamdulillah. Then he found her. She had prepared for him a nice meal, dinner. So he ate sabr. And then she adorned herself for him, wearing the sleep clothes and putting the makeup. So now he knows that his son is feeling better, and he's very quiet, doesn't feel any pain. He ate, and he was missing his wife, so they had an intimate relationship. Then after he ate and he enjoyed the intimate relationship, she said, Ya Aba Talha, I want to ask you a question. You know, what do you say if our neighbors give us something as an amana to use? Then they decided to collect it back. So they asked for it. What shall we do? He said, of course we shall give them back their property. It's an amana. It's a trust. We have no right to keep it. They want it, they can take it. So she said, Ya Aba Talha, indeed Allah has taken his amana. He said, what do you mean? She said, Allah has given us our son, and he took him back. Abu Talha was very upset, because not only that he lost his son, but also because he lost his son and he ate and he had sexual relations. You know, he's supposed to be grieved, to feel sorry, not to celebrate, but he didn't know. So when he went for Fajr, he complained to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about what Umm Sulaym did. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was very pleased with what she did, and he said, بارك الله لكما في ليلتكما. May Allah bless you both in that night, referring to the intimate relationship they had. May Allah grant you a goodly offspring. So he said that I saw from his offspring 10 who had memorized the Quran. Allah gave them better replacement. Upon losing anything, especially as-Safi, the dearest, your most favorite, your best person in this life. It could be your spouse. It could be your child. It could be one of your parents. It could be a friend. Remember one thing. I know what you're going to say. Oh, remember that all of us are going to die. No, I was going to say something else. Remember that our dearest at all, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is dead. He died. I want you to imagine the reaction of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who lived with him, who have been rightly guided by him, who have been saved by him. They entered Islam upon his hand. They fought next to him. They saw him. They laid their eyes on him. You know, Thawban was crying once, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, what is the matter? He said, every time I remember you will die and I will die, I don't know whether will I be able to see you in paradise as often, because in this dunya, every time I want to see you, I just go to the masjid. So I get to see you. So the Sahaba had an access to see the Prophet ﷺ every day, 5 times a day, for all the prayers. So when they miss him, all of a sudden, their calamity is much bigger and greater. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the best condolence to any of you if you lose a loved one is to remember my death, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So fact number one, innaka mayitun wa innahum mayitun, kullu man alayha fan wa abqa wajhu rabbika dhul jalali wal ikram. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam died, his companions died, his enemies died, and every living creature will vanish. None will remain other than Allah the Almighty, Dhul Jalali wal Ikram. If this is the case, then calm down. It is okay to cry, it is okay to feel grieved, to be sorry, but not to object, because it will not bring back the dead to life no matter what you do. If all the human beings and the jinn, the best doctors at all of the entire world, got together in order to extend the life of this patient, to give him a few minutes more to live, he's dead. That's it. لكل أجل كتاب. So this is the meaning of لله تعالى ما أخذ وله ما أعطى وكل شيء عنده بأجل مسمى, and everything with him has a limited time. فمرها فلتصبر ولتحتسب. If this is the case, you cannot change the fact. Death is inevitable, and all of us are going through it, one after another, and it doesn't recognize young or old, male or female, healthy or sick, rich or poor. It chooses based on the term that the person is supposed to depart this life at. So be patient. والتحتسب. The word والتحتسب أو احتسابا has been mentioned repeatedly in the Sunnah. الاحتساب is to anticipate the reward, to do whatever you do out of faith, and to trust Allah's promise that I want to get the reward, and that's why I'm going to be patient. So you will definitely get that reward. So الاحتساب, من صام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. إيمانا واحتسابا. Whoever observes fasting during Ramadan out of faith and احتسابا, يعني anticipating the reward from Allah, he will get the promised reward. What is the promised reward? All his previous sins will be forgiven. من قام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. Likewise, الاحتساب. So when you lose a loved one and you endure this calamity patiently, why? Why are you controlling your tongue and you're not jumping around, you're not screaming, you're not saying awful statements? Because you trust Allah's promise. If you're patient, He will give you that much. What will He give you? Huh? In the hadith, or the Qabr hadith, which was studied in the previous episode, if one loses a son and he becomes patient, Allah will build him a house in paradise, and the house will be named Bayt al-Hamd, the house of praise. Secondly, if a person loses a loved one, whether a husband, a wife, a child, a boy or a girl or a parent, as long as he is your most loved person and you're patient, then al-Jannah is due for him. So al-ihtisab is to anticipate the promised reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you will get it. And now with the new chapter, chapter number 153, and it is in the same line, what is lawful and what is not lawful with regards to the practices that the family members of a dead person may do to show their grief, their sorrow, and their remorse. Chapter number 153, باب جواز البكاء على الميت بغير ندب ولا نياحة. جواز البكاء على الميت, which means the permissibility of mere crying upon losing a loved one, for a dead person or over a dead person, as long as it is just mere crying, it doesn't include wailing, screaming, shouting. So an-niyaha is the wailing. Okay, the first hadith is a hadith which is agreed upon its authenticity. We studied this hadith before عن ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عاد سعد بن عبادة ومعه عبد الرحمن بن عوف وسعد بن أبي وقاص وعبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنهم فبكى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فلما رأى القوم بكاء رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بكوا فقال ألا تسمعون إن الله لا يعذب بدمع العين ولا بحزن القلب ولكن يعذب بهذا أو يرحم وأشار إلى لسانه. متفق عليه. عبد الله بن عمر, may Allah be pleased with him and his father, narrated that the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, visited Sa'd ibn Ubadah when he was severely ill and he died during this illness. He was accompanied by Abdul Rahman ibn Auf, and he was accompanied by Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas and Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, may Allah be pleased with all of them. So three companions were with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Two of them are among the 10 heaven-bound companions, Abdurrahman ibn Auf and Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas. فَبَكَى رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ, and the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, began to weep. When his companions saw this, their tears also started flowing. So the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, said, do you not hear? Allah does not punish for shedding of tears or the grief of the heart, but he punishes or bestows mercy for the utterance of this. And he pointed to his tongue, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From this hadith we understand Sa'd ibn Ubadah, by the way, was the chieftain of Al-Khazraj. We have two famous names, Sa'd ibn Mu'adh and Sa'd ibn Ubadah. Sa'd ibn Ubadah radiallahu anhu was the leader and the chieftain of Al-Khazraj, the tribe of Al-Khazraj. And when he was very sick and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to visit him, he started crying. So the Sahaba, Abdurrahman ibn Auf, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, the three companions who were with him, they too started crying. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained to them, for mere crying, there is no problem. That's mercy. The problem is in this. Then he pointed to his tongue. Only when you start uttering something which displeases Allah, then the person will be worthy of punishment. Such as, why do you do that to us? Why do you always take our loved ones? Why do you deprive me from my daddy? Why do you do this to my son? He's my only son. Why? Are you questioning the Creator? Are you questioning His judgment and His wisdom? None has the right to question Allah the Almighty. He does whatever He wills, whenever He wants, and no one questions Him. And He is the most merciful indeed. So if a person utters something which displeases Allah, he will be punished. And if a person utters something which does please Allah, as we studied in the previous hadith, once he will build him a house in paradise, once Jannah will be due to him, and once when he says, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un, then Allah the Almighty will descend His blessings upon him, will shower him or them with their mercy. And Allah the Almighty already decided that they are among the rightly guided ones. أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ صَلَوَاتٌ مِّن رَبِّهِمْ وَرَحْمَةٌ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُهْتَدُونَ. The three incredible qualities that a person will get when his utterance upon being afflicted with a calamity is إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. We all belong to Allah and unto Him we shall return, while being patient. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has already decided and informed the companions that mere crying is no problem. Being grieved, that's normal. You know, when you learn something sweet, you know, you feel it's sweet. Very salty, say it's bitter or salty. Very hot, you say it's hot. No one can blame you for that. When you lose a loved one, you're grieved. No one can blame you for that. It is okay. The only thing that becomes blameworthy is what you utter, what you do. So if you're patient and you say what is good, you'll be rewarded. And if you're not patient, if you keep jumping to the roof, if you object and curse, if you accuse Allah of lacking wisdom, you're blameworthy. And whoever is dead will remain dead. Your utterance will not bring him or her back to life, will not improve their condition whatsoever. That is the meaning of وَلَكِنْ يُعَذِّبُ بِهَذَا أَوْ يَرْحَمُ. Yet he punishes or he bestows mercy only by this or because of this. And he pointed to his tongue, the utterance of the tongue. The following hadith is what we studied in the beginning of today's episode, which was the last hadith of the previous chapter, chapter number 152. The hadith of Usama ibn Zayd once again, but now we are getting the rest of the hadith. What Imam Nawawi does, may Allah have mercy on him, in each chapter he chooses the suitable ahadith or ayat, if there is any. Okay, he doesn't have to quote the entire hadith. He may take the segment which will deliver the meaning that is in line with the chapter that he is talking about. So we said in the previous chapter, he was teaching us what a person should say when a loved one is dying or is dead. Now, he died already, and we're going to see the reaction of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Do you remember what is the name of this chapter? The chapter deals with the permissibility of mere crying or being grieved. The grief of the heart, it is okay. And the, you know, the prohibition against wailing, cursing, and objecting to Allah's decree. Hadith number 926. عن أسامة بن زيد رضي الله عنهما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رفع إليه ابن ابنته وهو في الموت ففاضت عينا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال له سعد ما هذا يا رسول الله قال هذه رحمة جعلها الله تعالى في قلوب عباده وإنما يرحم الله من عباده الرحماء. متفق عليه. In this hadith of Usama ibn Zayd, he narrated that the grandson of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the child of Zainab, the daughter of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was presented to him while the child was in his last breath. In the previous hadith we learned that when Zainab sent a messenger to him that you should come, and the Prophet ﷺ told him what she should say, then eventually by the end he by himself went to visit his daughter and to witness this moment. So when the son was between his hands and in his last breath, tears began to flow from his eyes, peace be upon him. So Sa'd radiyallahu an said to him, what is this, O Prophet of Allah? He said, it is mercy which Allah has placed in the hearts of his servants. Allah bestows his mercy on those who are merciful. إِنَّمَا يَرْحَمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الرحماء. So crying, you know, over the death of a loved one is very normal. That is the norms. And that is perfectly fine. And this is a sign of mercy, you know? Especially when you see the person in the agonies of death and in his or her last breath. So when the person starts crying, you know, feeling sorry for the loss of this loved one, or for the departure, or for the pain that he or she is suffering, this is a good sign. This is a sign of mercy. And Allah the Almighty bestows mercy upon whomever He wills, and He bestows mercy upon those who are merciful to His creation. So brothers and sisters, mere crying is okay. Feeling grief in your heart for the loss of loved one is perfectly okay. And now we will get into another hadith which is agreed upon its authenticity, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, when we speak about how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam reacted in these situations, guess what? While he was the dearest to Allah and his most beloved and the seal of the prophethood and a guide to mankind and all of that and mercy to everything that exists, but wallahi, he suffered most. I'm not only talking about suffering from the opposition of the Meccan chieftains or from At-Ta'if or from the Munafiqeen in Medina only, or from the Romans only, or the Persians. His suffering and his life, which was full of turmoils, and his patience and endurance of patience included that losing all his children in his life. The only child who survived him was Fatima radiallahu anha. She died 6 months after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away. But he lost all his children. He lost his sons when they were very young, Ibrahim and Abdullah. He lost Al-Qasim. And upon that, instead of receiving the condolences, the Meccan pagans showed joy and delight. They were celebrating and they called him Al-Abtar. What does it mean? Inshallah, we'll discuss this after we come back from a short break, so please stay tuned.
Rasulullah, Habiballah, Rasulullah, Rasulullah, Habiballah.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. So before the break, we're talking about how much suffering Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, went through, even though he was the dearest to Allah the Almighty, which means that whenever you are being loved by Allah, you will be also tested. And tests and trials could be the means of raising the rank of the person to the highest, such as in the case of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In the case of others, tests and trials are to purify the person from some of their sins, to remit some of errors that they bear on their shoulders. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith, أشد الناس بلاء الأنبياء ثم الذين يلونهم ثم الذين يلونهم. The most severely tested people are the prophets. Those who suffered most are the prophets, even though they are the dearest to Allah the Almighty. Look how much suffering Prophet Moses, peace be upon him, went through, or Isa alayhi salam, or Prophet Ayyub, who is patient for his sickness for 18 years and for the loss of his 10 sons, and he was very wealthy and he lost everything. Inna wajadnahu sabira نعم العبد إنه أواب. Allah said, most surely we found him patient. He endured all of that patiently. How excellent is such servant of ours. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he lost his son, his only son back then, so the Meccan chieftain said, دعوه إنه أبتر. Now we don't have to worry about him. He's أبتر. Abtar is cut off. He doesn't have an offspring. No one is going to bear his name. No one will remember him. The question is, the person who uttered this evil utterance, who used to have 10 sons and used to brag about his wealth. Now, who recalls him? Who mentions his name? Is it in the Wikipedia? Does anybody celebrate his name? Does he have any markers, any benefits, any use in life? No. But the name Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even though he did not have a son to bear his name, is the most famous name, including in the non-Muslim countries. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah the Almighty said to him, "Inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar." Indeed, O Muhammad, your enemy and your opponent is the one who will be cut off. He's not even going to be mentioned. And if he is to be mentioned, in an evil context. So al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam suffered, but not because he did something wrong, but because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala purifies his loved ones. He chooses them and he gives them a great deal of sabr and capacity to bear these calamities patiently, so that he keeps promoting them until they achieve the highest status before him. يُبْتَلَى الْمَرْءُ عَلَى قَدْرِ دِينَهُ. The person would receive tests and trials in proportion with his religious commitment, his or hers, of course. Look at this hadith, which is discussing the moment on which Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam lost his young son Ibrahim alayhi salam. عن أنس رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم دخل على ابنه إبراهيم رضي الله عنه وهو يجود بنفسه فجعلت عينا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم تذرفان فقال له عبد الرحمن بن عوف وأنت يا رسول الله فقال يا ابن عوف إنها رحمة ثم أتبعها بأخرى فقال إن العين تدمع والقلب يحزن ولا نقول إلا ما يرضي ربنا وإنا لفراقك يا إبراهيم لمحزونون رواه البخاري. And a segment of it was also collected by Imam Muslim. Anas ibn Malik, may Allah be pleased with him, narrated that the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, came to his son Ibrahim, may Allah be pleased with him, when he was in his last breath. So the eyes of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, began shedding tears. Abdul Rahman ibn Auf, radiyallahu anhu, who was there, said, O Messenger of Allah, you too weep, do you? So he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, Ya ibn Auf, O ibn Auf, this is mercy. Then he began to weep again another time, and he said, indeed, the eyes are shedding tears and the heart is grieved, and we will not say except what pleases our Lord. O Ibrahim, indeed we are grieved by your departure and by your loss. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a human being, and he is the most merciful, and he was grieved for the loss of his son Ibrahim alayhi salam. And here I remember the incident of this woman who was at the graveyard. She was wailing, she was cursing, and when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam passed by her, he said, Ya amat Allah, ittaqi allaha wasbiri. Fear your Lord, be patient. Why do you do that? So this woman said, ilayka anni, which means, leave me alone, get out of my face. فَإِنَّكَ لَمْ تُصَبْ بِمُصِيبَتِي. You've not been afflicted with my calamity to teach me what to do and to instruct me to be patient. Because you're not in my situation, you're advising me to be patient. But if you're in my situation, you would know what I've been through. Obviously, number one, she didn't know that was Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Number two, she didn't know that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam not only lost a son or two, he lost all his children and some of his grandchildren in his life, as I said, with the exception of Fatima, the daughter of Muhammad, who lived for 6 months after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So all his daughters, he lost 6 out of the 7, and he lost some grandchildren, and he lost 3 sons. May the peace and blessings be upon him. So later on, she recognized the personality of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They said, "Don't you know who's talking to you? It was the Prophet." So later on, she ran to his house and she said, "I'm sorry, I didn't recognize you." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam distracted her attention from recognizing him or not recognizing him. "It's not about me," he said. "Innama sabru and the sadmati al-ula." Forget about me. Patience and its observance is once you receive the shock of the calamity, not a while later. So brothers and sisters were studying this because no doubt somewhere right now somebody is grieved with the loss of their children. A couple who have been trying for years to have a child, and after 18 years Allah blessed them with a baby boy, and then at the age of 3, 4, or 5 he got very sick, had severe fever, and he was pronounced dead like that. You know, some people can lose their mind, some people can say awful stuff, can accuse Allah of being not merciful, of being whatever, God forbid. Why? Because they were not ready for this moment. These classes, we educate ourselves to learn as Muslims how should we react whenever we're afflicted. We understand for certain everything belongs to Him. We ourselves are amana, you know. Our body parts are amana. They are gifts from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah decided to take any, He is leaving for you other blessings. If He decided to take one of your children, perhaps you have others. And if you don't, then He has become farata laka ila al-jannah. What does it mean? Today I said, let me go to pray in a masjid which is far away, because normally there is a janaza or a funeral prayer. And then after we pray dhuhr, they brought 3 funerals, and one of them was a baby. His father was wrapping him like in a piece of towel like that, and he brought him to the mihrab. And then we were talking about, subhanallah, you know why we make dua when we announce the funeral prayer? We say as-salatu ala al-amwat. Let's offer the funeral for those, or over those who are already here, of the dead Muslims. But whenever we have a child, we specify we have a child or we have children. Why? Because the dua will be directed for the benefit of the parents. As for the child, he's already in the kafala of Ibrahim alayhi salam. He's in paradise. The children who die before the age of puberty, to Muslim parents, they go straight to heaven, because the pen of recording their actions did not record any bad deed for them, only good deeds. So they go straight to heaven. And that is the meaning of becoming faratan ila al-jannah. Yani they go to paradise ahead of their parents. And they pick up their parents, provided the parents were patient over the calamity of losing their child. So in the funeral prayer, we ask Allah to bless the parents of the dead child, he or she, to have mercy on them, to give them a better substitute, something better than what they have lost, and to make their child, you know, ahead of them to paradise, and so on. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, what we say, or what we should say upon losing a loved one: crying is perfectly okay. What is not okay is the utterance of the tongue to object to Allah's decree, or to wail, or to express how life will be miserable without this person who is everything in your life or to you in this life. So he said, "Inna al-ayna la tadma'." Indeed, the eyes are shedding tears. "Wa inna al-qalba la yahzan." And indeed, the heart is grieved. "Wa la naqulu illa ma yurdi rabbana." But yet we do not say anything but what pleases our Lord. وَإِنَّا لِفِرَاقِكَ يَا إِبْرَاهِيمُ لَمَحْزُنُونَ. And indeed, Ibrahim, we feel very sorry for your loss and for your departure. Brothers and sisters, it is very important to understand that we're learning this in order to embody it in our daily lives, in order to be ready to practice once it is needed. So may Allah make it easy for us to benefit from this useful knowledge, from the ayat and the hadith of the Messenger of Allah, and put them into practice. By that, we've come to the end of today's edition of your program, Gardens of the Pious. And until next week, I leave you all in the care of Allah. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله الله our God is the greatest the one and only glory to him he wanted humans to be the best and give his best religion to them. Allah our God is the greatest, the one and only glory to him. He wanted humans to be the best and give his best religion to them. So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about it in paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling the best with the cheapest price. So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about hell and paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling their best with the cheapest price.